Spring has nearly sprung here in Wisconsin, and I have such a case of cabin fever that I decided to bring at least the introduction of our show outside this week. Of course, I'm standing on the empty lot next to our church, where, Lord willing, this green grass will be dug up very soon, and the foundation will be laid for our new fellowship hall. This is a very exciting time for us as members of St. Paul's, and perhaps the excitement has been put a little bit on the back burner because of all of the other things that are going on. I just wanted to shoot this out here to remind you that we do have some exciting changes that will be coming on this very piece of property. One request that I have already made in the email, but I'm going to verbally make here at the beginning of the service, is that this week and maybe next week as well, if you would take a picture of you and or your family worshiping at home and then email it to me, I will compile them together and put them in the video so that we can at least see each other, even though we're not able to gather together yet. You certainly can dress up for these photos like you would if you're going to church, or you can take these pictures in your pajamas, which is probably how you're actually watching the video anyways. If you're not a member of our congregation, I really do encourage you to send me a picture as well and list who you are and where you're at, and I will include that in our video next week so that we can see the impact that these videos are making outside of our little circle here in Dodge County. Children, if you're looking for an art project this week, maybe you could consider drawing or sketching your family worshiping at home, and send those to me, and I'll try and include those in some way as well. May the Lord bless your worship this morning as we continue to explore the Acts of the Apostles during these Sundays after Easter. We're going to pick up today where we left off last week with the second half of the Apostle Peter's Pentecost sermon. May God bless your worship today. We continue now with the morning litany. In the morning, O Lord, you hear my voice. In the morning, I lay my request before you, and you wait in expectation. We do not make request of you because we are righteous, but because of your great mercy. May the favor of the Lord our God rest upon us. Establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. Let me live that I may praise you, and may your laws sustain me. Our scripture reading for this Sunday after Easter is taken from the book of Acts, chapter 2. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews, and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, Brothers, what shall we do? Peter replied, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. With many other words, he warned them and he pleaded with them, Save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as he had need. Every day, they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Peter preached a short sermon, and about 3,000 people came to faith in Jesus in one day. What a pastoral high that must have been for Peter, especially since a few weeks earlier, Peter was nothing but a broken down disappointment with hot, bitter tears streaking down his face. Now, forgiven and restored by Jesus, given his marching orders to feed my sheep, and filled with a fresh outpouring of the Holy Spirit, Peter preaches a simple law gospel sermon to the crowd gathered on that Pentecost day. And look at what happened. 3,000 lost souls found and rescued. One lost soul rescued is exciting enough, but 3,000 all at once. It must have been an awesome day for Peter. We're told that Peter stood up with the 11. He raised his voice and he addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. Therefore, let all of Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other disciples, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children, for all who are far off, and for all whom the Lord our God will call." Some claim that the message of the Bible is obtuse and opaque, that it requires interpretation by an educated reader. But there's nothing to interpret here. The language is clear. There is no parable with a hidden meaning. There is no head-scratcher like Jesus said, the first shall be last and the last shall be first. You see, Peter is a simple man with a simple message. Eloquence is just simply not his thing. A high IQ is not required to understand what Peter is saying here. What is required? Peter writes, "Listen carefully to what I say." That's what's required, is that you listen carefully. The Holy Spirit has given Peter a one-sentence message. So listen carefully. "Let all of Israel be assured of this," Peter says to the crowd. "God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ." Peter starts out by telling the crowd, "You can be assured of this. We are dealing in facts here. This is not personal conjecture on the part of Peter. This is not fake news. You yourselves were witnesses of these facts. Let all of Israel be assured of this God. Let all of Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ." This is a one-sentence sermon that has everything it needs to bring 3,000 people to faith. We dissect it. "You crucified Jesus." God made him Lord and Christ. You subjected him to shame and degradation. God raised him up and gave him the name that is above every name. He is the Christ. This Jesus that you crucified is Lord. He is the master and the supreme authority. To kill someone is certainly a horrible crime. And only the sickest of sociopaths are not bothered after taking part in such a horrible act. But to kill the Christ, to kill the Lord of the universe, was an even worse crime with even greater guilt. This brief reminder from Peter about what they had done to Jesus created panic in their hearts. The text tells us that they were cut to the heart. Now, this public panic that ensued when Peter preached the law to them, it was wholly justified. Listen to what happened. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Could it be that God is using this whole pandemic to remind us of what we really ought to panic about? How is it that our whole world is so panicked by a virus that has a relatively low potential to kill the body, and yet the same world that is in a full-blown panic about that pays no attention to the sin and rebellion that will surely kill the soul? Our world has made some immediate and radical changes to their lives because this virus might affect them. And yet this same world thinks nothing about engaging in full-blown acts of sexual immorality, casual sex, killing unborn children, pursuing unscriptural divorces, and selfishly abusing drugs and alcohol. The overall and widespread acceptance of these sins and so many more lead millions of precious souls down the path to hell, guaranteed. It's not something that might happen to them, but unrepented, it will lead to an unending hell. And yet, there is no immediate change. There is no panic. There is no radical change to their lives. It's business as usual. But before we spend too much time pointing the finger at the big bad world and getting on our high horses, we should ask if there is panic in our hearts over our own wretched sins. Or have we grown too comfortable with sin? We know we should not drink so much, and yet we do. We know that we should not tear down people behind their backs, and yet we do that too. We know that we should not live as if my happiness is the only thing that really matters in this world, and yet so often that's how we live. We know we should spend more time in God's Word and in prayer than we do on social media or Netflix, and yet we don't. These sins and others really ought to cause inside of us a full-blown panic and immediate and radical change, because these sins, not just the sins that are out there in the world, but these sins and many others that are in our hearts have the potential to kill us if they are left to reign in our hearts unrepented. If left to rule in our hearts, they will lead us also to hell. Sadly, so often, just like the world, we worry about the things that we really shouldn't worry about and don't worry about the things that we really ought to worry about. With the crowd that day standing before Peter, hearing this sharp preaching of the law, we too cry out, "Brothers, what shall we do? What can we do about this state of sin, not just in the world, but in our own hearts?" Peter's answer Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off and for all whom the Lord our God will call. That can't be it, can it? Repent. Be sorry for my sins and turn away from my sins. There must be something more to salvation than that. Because to repent and to be sorry for my sins isn't even something that I can do on my own. It's really not my work, it's God's work. God's word is what works repentance and sorrow in my heart over my sins. Without his holy law to convict me, I would never be sorry for my sins. It would just keep making excuses for them. And yet, what does Peter say to these people? This crowd before him, the very people who put Jesus to death on the cross and were guilty of terrible crimes, he says to them, very simply, repent and be baptized, every one of you. This message is for all the people in the crowd that day. Those who cried out, crucify him, in Pilate's court, and those that weren't there. Those that had an active role in Jesus' death, and those who had a passive role like ours. Those with Abraham's blood coursing through their veins, and Gentiles alike. Those who are married and those who are single, young and old alike, be baptized, every one of you. It's passive, isn't it? Be baptized. It is something that's done to you. Just as repentance is really the work of God done to you, so also baptism is the work of God that is done to you. And just look at what baptism does. Again, this is such simple stuff. You don't need to be a seminary graduate in order to understand the doctrine of baptism. Baptism is for all. Could Peter have said it any clearer to the large crowd gathered before him? Repent and be baptized, every one of you. Peter does not limit baptism to the adults in the crowd that day. He doesn't say, well, those of you who are able to make a decision for Jesus, you can come forward and be baptized. No, he says the opposite. He says this promise is for you and your children. Baptism is also clearly not something that we do for God. This text makes it so clear. Instead, it is not our way of blessing God to be baptized, but instead it is God's way of blessing us. Listen to how Peter described it. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Christ Jesus for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. You see, baptism isn't our idea. It's not my idea. It's not your idea. It's God's idea. Who is the one who is in charge here? Who is the subject and who is the object of the verb? Who is the one who's doing the heavy lifting here in Peter's sermon, in calling people to repentance, in calling to people to baptism, in bringing sinners to faith? Isn't it clear? It's so clear. Peter says, for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. God is the one who calls people to repentance and to baptism. The Holy Spirit is the one that grants the forgiveness of sins. This is all God's business here. Yes, we are graciously invited to partake in the blessings and to make them our own, but we can't take credit for them. Who really gives credit to the beggar who merely accepts an invitation to a hot meal? all the beggar did is agree to eat the hot meal that was offered to him. The credit in that situation goes entirely to the one who offered the gift of a hot meal to the beggar, not to the one who received it. And so it is here in repentance and baptism. God is the one who gives it, and we thank him for that. With many other words, Peter warned them and he pleaded with them, "Save yourselves from this corrupt generation." Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. Now, Peter's whole sermon is not recorded here for us word for word, but the main point is so clear. Peter wants the crowd that day to have what he now has. And he's pleading with them. He's begging them. This corrupt generation that was standing in front of him, they were on the path to hell. They were on that wide and easy road to hell, that road that is paved with all sorts of good intentions, but without much else. Maybe they didn't even realize where they were heading. And these were his people that were standing there. These were fellow Jews. And so he warns them. He warns them with many words, in the same way a bridge out sign warns drivers of the dangers ahead. Peter warns them and he says, "Repent, turn around." Now, again, this message of Peter's, it's not fancy. It's not eloquent. It's simple. And yet the Holy Spirit used it to bring 3,000 people to repentance and to baptism and to faith in Jesus as their Savior in a single day. God's word works. He uses flawed people like Peter, like me, like every pastor you have ever had or will ever have, to do his work. And what a work it is. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common, selling their possessions and goods. They gave to anyone as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Peter, the 11, the 3,000 were all changed men, women, and children. They could not, they would not live in fear anymore. They had been changed on the inside. Baptism, the forgiveness of sins, the Holy Spirit, all of those things work real change in the lives of believers. And Peter tells us how the thousands of new believers were now boldly devoting themselves first to the apostles' teaching, then to the fellowship, then to the sacrament, and then to prayer. Does that look like what we do each week together as a family in Christ? I hope so. Even in these unusual times that we are experiencing right now, we're doing exactly what the apostles did at first. Those first believers, we are devoting ourselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship with one another, to prayer, and to the sacrament. Not only were those first Christians devoted to Jesus, they were devoted to each other. They shared what they had with each other. In other words, they acted like a family. They supported each other. They did not selfishly keep everything for themselves. Does that also look like you? Devoted to the word and also devoted to sharing what you have with others? By God's grace, it does. Maybe not every day, but it does. just as God worked in those first disciples to create a willingness to devotion and to share, so he has done the same thing in your heart too. You are here watching a video and also generously offering your first fruit gifts, even when it would be so easy to skip it, right? No one's going to know if you watched this video or not. No one's going to know if you sent your offerings in or not. But you are baptized children of God. You have been bought. You have been forgiven. You have the Holy Spirit living inside of you. And you have the sure hope of heaven in your future. And that has brought change into your life. So what's left? They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. I know just how easy it is to focus on everything that's been taken away from you right now. I know how frustrating it is to have the government tell you what you can and cannot do. I know how frustrating it is to have your ability to support your family be restricted and it's beyond your control. I'm frustrated too. And while we are not allowed to gather for fellowship or to break bread right now, no one, and I mean no one, can stop you from praising God for who he is and what he has done. You see, our Lord is still at work even now. He is not sitting in his house in heaven, frustrated and powerless like we are. Right now, in this place and in thousands of other places, he is powerfully using his word to grow his church. He used Peter's simple message, and he even uses this simple message to add to the church those who are being saved and to strengthen those who are already members of the church. That he uses humble people like us. That he uses your humble offerings and your humble support to do this powerful work around the world is reason enough to praise God. Please know that the Lord and his Holy Spirit are not staying safer at home at this time. The Lord is at work. He used simple Peter. He uses simple me. And he uses simple you to do it. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Amen. We join in Luther's morning prayer together. I thank you, my Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger. And I pray that you would keep me this day also from sin and every evil, that all my doings and life may please you. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the wicked foe may have no power over me. Amen. May the grace of the Lord Jesus sanctify us and keep us from evil. May Christ drive all harmful things far from us and purify both our souls and our bodies. May Christ bind us to himself by the bond of love, and may his peace abound in our hearts. Amen.
A song of thanksgiving to God the Creator, triumphantly raise, who fashioned and made us, protected and stayed us, who guided us on to the end of our days. His banners are o'er us. His light goes before us, a pillar of fire shining forth in the night. Till shadows have vanished and darkness is banished, as forward we travel from light into light.
His law he enforces, the stars in their courses, the sun in his orbit obediently shine. The hills and the mountains, the rivers and fountains, the deeps of the ocean proclaim him divine.
We too should be voicing by love and rejoicing, with glad adoration, a song let us raise.
Till all things now living unite in thanksgiving to God in the highest, hosanna and praise.
Our love and rejoicing with glad adoration, a song let us raise.
Till all things now living unite in thanksgiving to God in the highest, hosanna and praise.
For our announcements this week, I want to call your attention to the fact that the Synod Discipleship Committee has put together some new family devotions. They're available at the link that's in the announcement section of the bulletin, as well as on the Wells Facebook page. They'll be posted on there every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Received a request to pass this information along to you, that if you are out of work or hurting, the community pantry in Dodge County is here to help you. They have received a large shipment of government food. Simply call Larry at the number that's there in the service folder to set up an appointment and pick up your food. Want to continue to encourage you to check out the online giving option that you have. If you feel comfortable doing that, the steps are laid out in the bulletin for you. Just a final reminder, if you haven't done it yet, please take a picture of yourself or your family watching this service and send it to me, and I will do my best to stitch some of those together so that we can stay connected to each other even during this time. Until the Lord brings us back together in his home, may he send his guardian angels to bless and to keep each one of you. Have a blessed week. Amen.